Hey, it's Conway here. I got a whole house water filtration system from Purigen Water because I never want to worry about the safety of my kids' tap water. Plus, no wasting money on bottled water and no plastic to recycle. And no calcium buildup ever. Best thing? You get free lifetime service with Purigen and it takes up very little space. Call Purigen Water and for a limited time, when you buy a whole house water system, you get a 6-stage alkaline drink system for free. 844-80-WATER. 844-80-WATER or PuriganWater.com. That's P-U-R, again, water.com.
The level of connection you feel in your home dramatically influences your experiences there. Get the tools to control that connection in your communities with the first multifamily platform that unifies management and resident experiences to create smart apartments. Talk to a RealPage consultant today to see how your properties can meet the future of multifamily with the Smart Building Suite.
AM 640, live everywhere on the iHeartRadio app. This is the Bill Handel Show. Bill will be here in a little bit, phasing in some studio time, and you're going to be hearing a lot more of Bill very soon. In the meantime, LA County says they are going to put in a new health order. It will require proof of COVID-19 vaccination at indoor bars and wineries and breweries and nightclubs and lounges all across the county. And also outdoor mega events. This would be crowds of more than 10,000. You will have to show a vaccine verification or a recent negative coronavirus test to attend that. For the outdoor events, they have until October 7th to comply. The bars and the wineries, they're going to have to require customers and employees to have at least one dose of the vaccine by October 7th, be fully vaccinated by November 4th. So that's the way it's heading. Particularly because, you know, winter is coming. And I know in Southern California, winter is not the same thing as it is in, say, Minnesota, but it's still generally cooler here in the wintertime than the summertime. And apparently when the weather gets colder, people stay inside more. You know the thing, flu season. Flu season is going to also be COVID season. And that's why you're seeing a lot of these rules gearing up. They would like to very much avoid a big winter spike in COVID cases. So that's what they're doing. Now, it's not just LA County. This is going on all over the country where governments are imposing these kinds of mandates to go into various kinds of businesses. And here's where we see a new frontier, I think. There is a landlord who is requiring residents to be vaccinated before they move in or before renewing a lease. Now, this is at an apartment building in Florida, and the landlord, I guess, got tired of the employees being exposed to COVID. So Santiago Alvarez, the landlord, has sent a notice to everybody, and already there's been at least one complaint filed with the Florida Department of Agriculture and Consumer Services. There's a person, a woman who lives in the building. She's a security guard, and she says she should be allowed to renew her lease without having to disclose her personal health information. Incorrect, ma'am. There is zero obligation for a landlord to renew a lease. If you're talking about trying to evict somebody before a lease is over, that's a different kettle of fish. But once your lease is up, there's zero obligation to continue doing business with you. And that's why I think this landlord can get away with it, because you can decline to give a lease to a new tenant or renew somebody's lease for any reason except the narrow list of forbidden reasons, discrimination based on protected class. Otherwise, you could say, I understand you're a Marlins fan. Well, when your lease is up, we're not going to renew it. There's nothing you can do about it. And to say you have to show proof of vaccination or we will not renew your lease, I don't see that you have a leg to stand on in court. Unless you show a health exemption or a religious exemption and they say, I don't care. Then I think you'd have a strong case in court. Because now you're either being discriminated against based on religion or based on disability. But if you're just, I don't want to get the vaccine, they don't have to rent to you. And he's not talking about kicking people out while they're in a lease. He's waiting until the natural cycle allows him to get rid of anybody he doesn't want there anymore. Is this going to become a thing? I don't know. But this guy's definitely making national headlines for doing it. And there may be other property management companies and property owners who say, yeah, you know what? I don't really want unvaccinated people living in my building either. Listen, here's the thing. One would be your assessment of the health risk of unvaccinated people living in the building. But since I have broad discretion as a landlord about who I can rent to or not rent to, I might also want to think about, do I want someone who is displaying that attitude about a vaccine, do I want them in my property? Because what other things are they going to be defiant about? What other customary things are they going to have a problem with? Are they more likely to damage my property because they don't care? Are they more likely to break no smoking rules or no pet rules or any other kinds of rules? Maybe. Maybe I'm being wildly unfair and judging someone wrongly, or maybe I'm on to something. But if I had a piece of property, I'd be very concerned about who was living in that property, and I'd probably be looking for any avenue to be comfortable about who I'm leasing to. And I'm going to take every legal method of controlling who I'm leasing to. Because guess what? That's my right as a property owner. So it's going to be harder and harder to walk around as a UBC, unvaccinated by choice. It's just going to be more difficult. And that's fine. I know that it's talked about as a matter of freedom, right? Hey, if you require me to get a vaccine to come to work or to rent from you or to go into this bar, you're infringing on my freedom. But it's not really. I don't see it as an issue of freedom. And I don't think what you're asking for, honestly, is freedom. You're asking for massive accommodation. It's two different things. Because nobody's grabbing people and shoving a needle in their arm. That's not happening. That's absolutely a violation of your freedom. It's one of the most massive violations of your freedom there could be. This isn't what's happening. You're being given choices to make. You don't have to work where you're working if you don't like their policies. What if your employer said, from now on, we're going to have you punch a time card, and you'd say, no, you're infringing on my freedom. I want to be exempt from your policy. Most people would say, if you don't like it, go work somewhere else. Well, I think we're going to see with the vaccine mandates that it's the same choice that people will be faced with. And so here with this landlord, go live somewhere else. And guess what? You know, the woman I told you about, the security guard who filed the complaint, she decided, yeah, I'm just going to go live somewhere else. And that's how everybody gets their freedom. Everybody gets their freedom by dealing with the consequences of their choices. He gets to rent to who he wants to. She gets to live in a place that doesn't require vaccinations. Let's get a news update from Layla Muhammad. And then there's another way that fires here in the state are getting more dangerous that hasn't been talked about enough. This is KFI AM 640 live everywhere on the iHeartRadio app. KFI AM 640 live everywhere on the iHeartRadio app. Good morning. It's the Bill Handel Show. Bill will be along in a little bit here. He is phasing back into hosting parts of this show. And you can trust me on this. You will be hearing a lot more of Bill Handel on his own show very, very soon. Was that enough of a dramatic pause between the two varies? Let me try a longer one. You'll be hearing Bill Handel on his own show, a lot more of him very, very soon. Well, one of the aspects of the new state of fire here in California is that these fires are starting to do something they never did before. They've been doing a lot of things they didn't do before. One of the things they're doing that they didn't do before is burn higher and higher. The Calder Fire roared down upon the resort town of South Lake Tahoe. Thank goodness it did not destroy that town. But how did it get to the point where it even could? Because it had to burn from one side of the Sierra over to the other, and the way that you do it is you go over the top, burning at elevations of 8,000 feet and higher. This is another aspect of the new kinds of fires, which experts are saying it's the warming climate. The warming climate is leading to a couple of things that are leading to fires burning higher and higher than they used to. One of them is the snowpacks are melting more quickly each year. And also, of course, there's not as much snowpack. So when they do melt, not as much of the ground gets wet. So again, dry ground, we all know that. Rapid snow melt. Fires climbing higher and higher than they ever have before. There was a study, it was published 2-3 months ago in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. And the study concluded that because of climate change, there's an additional over 31,000 square miles of U.S. forests that are exposed to fire. And it used to be you knew with great certainty that fires weren't going to get higher than about 8,000 feet. Once in a blue moon, a fire would creep past 8,000 feet, but it was very much not the norm. And therefore, you could say all this forest area is safe because it's all above 8,000 feet. We don't need to concern ourselves with protecting it from fire. Nature will protect it. Well, between 1984 and 2017, the average elevation at which a fire reached has gone up more than 1,400 feet. And the scientists have been looking at different ecological regions, so they're not just looking at the Sierras, for example. They're looking all over the country at mountain ranges. The three areas that are seeing the biggest increase in how high these fires burn are the Southern Rockies, the Middle Rockies, and the Sierra Nevada, which is a big problem for California, I guess, and Nevada, for that matter. I mean, before the year 2000, it would be a massive, because it was so rare, event for a fire in the Sierras to burn above 8,200 feet. Now, eight times as many fires do that than 20 years ago, 22 years ago. The Calder Fire did it. The Dixie Fire did it. Those aren't even necessarily the most extreme examples. In 2020, there was, in Colorado, the Cameron Peak Fire, and it went above 12,000 feet and actually jumped the Continental Divide. Now, this explains why the Calder Fire was able to get over that granite ridge, because it was able to burn up so high. The physical barriers are reduced. The forests at the higher elevations are dry. It used to be, even if it was drier below, once you got up to a certain elevation, the stuff up there would still be kind of moist. It's not the case anymore. And, of course, we don't have as much snowpack. Then what happens is you get a fire at a higher elevation. It burns off trees that provided cover to the snowpack to allow it to remain as snow a little longer. That cover's gone. The snowpack melts away quickly, but it's not releasing enough water to keep the stuff moist long enough to avoid being burned. So, hotter temperatures, drier air, stronger winds whipping around those embers, and now the fact that the fire has another direction that it can go. Because you used to think, well, it's burning up the side of the mountain, so we don't really care. Because it'll burn up to some point and it'll stop, and we're done. But now we have to worry every time that it'll burn all the way up and over and down the other side. Let's get a news update from Leila Mohammed. And then Brad Garrett will join us, ABC News crime and terrorism analyst and a former FBI agent. So he's the guy who would explain why the FBI is in such trouble right now over their non-handling of all of those abuse allegations against Larry Nassar. He knows how they should have handled it. He will tell us. It's KFI AM 640, live everywhere on the iHeartRadio app.
Well, I don't know what I don't know, so I kick my shoes off and run.
KFI AM 640 live everywhere on the iHeartRadio app. This is the Bill Handel Show. Wayne Resnick sitting in, although not for much longer today. Bill's going to be along in an hour, basically, as he phases in more studio time on his way to a full return. In the meantime, very pleased to have ABC News crime and terrorism analyst and, most importantly, for the story today, former FBI agent Brad Garrett is here. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Wayne.
Well, let's get right into it. There's a lot of heat being thrown at the FBI for not handling all those allegations against Larry Nassar properly. Please tell us what they should have done compared to what they did or didn't do.
So let's start with, this is some of the most egregious behavior I've ever seen from an FBI agent. So let's start with that. Go into the story in the middle of like June of 2015, one of the victims that testified yesterday called the FBI and spent 3 hours in a three-hour interview with an agent going over Nassar's multiple abuse of her and others in apparently such detail. She apparently shared stuff with this agent that she hadn't even shared with her mother. The courage it took to even have that call is so commendable. But the point being, the agent, I think, didn't ask her many questions, if any questions. He just listened to her. And they hung up, and he apparently did nothing. He didn't call or communicate with the Lansing, Michigan FBI office where Nassar was, Larry Nassar, the doctor in question here, who then, if they knew, could then immediately talk to Michigan State and other state and city county authorities about what the allegations are. Because I will tell you that that flag being run up the pole would have stopped Nassar and maybe even temporarily suspended potentially his medical license. But it didn't happen. And so the estimates are 70 to 100 plus more kids were sexually victimized by him as the result of these agents not doing their job.
Now, when you say this is outrageous behavior on their part,
yes.
Did they violate, is this a situation where they violated some kind of written procedurals manual, for example, or a clearly understood policy, or is it that they simply didn't exercise the basic judgment that you would expect from an FBI agent?
They didn't do their job. They didn't do their duty. You are obligated, particularly when you're talking about Wayne, of other people being victimized. They train new agents at Quantico that sexual predators don't stop until you stop them, because it's a compulsion, it's a desire, it's something that just overwhelms and takes them over, which clearly was going on with Nassar. And so the longer you wait, an hour, 2 hours, 2 days, the potential for more victims is going to be the reality. Everyone knows that. You don't even have to be trained to know that. And so it's such a dereliction of duty. There are all sorts of things about reporting these types of crimes immediately that this agent in particular totally ignored and violated, obviously, who, I guess, according to the FBI director, they finally fired 2 weeks ago.
Michael Langman.
Correct. And then the agent in charge, Jay Abbott, is also in the middle of this because it's unclear what Jay knew and didn't know. But, you know, he was getting or it was cozy with, USA Gymnastics, which is headquartered in Indianapolis, apparently looking for a job after he retired. Mm. And so, you know, what's that obviously looks horrible on this front end. We'll have to see how that sorts out. But you know, both of them, it's just shame on them for this ever happening. And, you know, the real question, and Christopher Wray was asked this multiple times yesterday by the senators, what does he put in place so this doesn't happen again? And I'm sure he has built safeguards into the system of double checks, et cetera. But, I mean, we all know it's a big outfit, just like a big police department. You're telling LAPD or LASO a new policy, that's great, but can you get everybody to adhere to it? You know, that's another story.
Now, I mean, you were in the FBI for a long time. You handled all kinds of different cases, so you know a lot of FBI agents, and I'm sure some were better than others. Do you have any idea, like, why specifically these agents didn't do their job, or is it a mystery to you? You just know they didn't.
It's a total mystery. I have thought, Wayne, about this long and hard. Agents that I did not respect, that basically were lazy, would not have done this. They would have, at the very least, listened to this girl and immediately at least picked up the phone and called Lansing, Michigan, and would give them a summary, or should have given them a summary as to what he heard. And then follow it up with a written report a day or two later. I mean, that's not heavy lifting. And that didn't occur. I will tell you, I could line up 100 FBI agents that I worked with, and they would all be aghast this ever happened. It's just so egregious, as I said earlier. So both of them are out of the FBI. As you mentioned, one's been fired and the other retired in 2018.
Oh, so he got out before all this heat came down. Is it possible, you know the timeline of investigations and things like that. Is it possible he kind of saw the writing on the wall, though, and got out before he would have to stand there and take the heat directly?
Probably, or maybe he was even said, you better retire, or this is what's coming, in effect. I don't know the answer to that, but based on the timing, he obviously had enough time in and he was old enough to retire, but then he left. And, you know, internally, there's not really much else the FBI can do, I don't think, to either one of them. Wayne, could they be charged criminally? I don't know. I think that's also I'm not a lawyer, but I think that's also fuzzy. It's interesting, you know, DOJ, the lawyers, were invited to the Senate hearing yesterday, and they chose not to come because I think they're stuck about what they're going to charge them with. And there's a thing about false reporting. It's sometimes hard to prove. It really carries, I mean, could you go to prison? People have gone to prison for it, but I don't know. We'll have to see. Clearly, I bet the two of them are going to get caught up, if they're not already caught up, in civil cases.
Oh, my. Yeah, I didn't think about that angle. This could keep them in civil court for the rest of their lives. Brad, thank you so much. Always good to talk to you.
You're welcome. Take care, Wayne.
Okay. Talk to you again. Brad Garrett, ABC News crime and terrorism analyst. Let's get a news update from Layla Mohammed. And then everybody knows about Britney Spears and her conservatorship and tons of the details about it. And it looks like it's probably going away because even her own father now has filed and said, yeah, if she doesn't want to be under conservatorship, that's A-okay with me. There's another child star also under a conservatorship, and you're not hearing anywhere near the amount of information about it. Who is it, and why aren't they getting the same attention? This is KFI AM 640, live everywhere on the iHeartRadio app. Everywhere on the iHeartRadio app. This is the Bill Handel Show. Bill will be along at 8:30, putting in some studio time, because guess what? You're going to be hearing a lot more of Bill Handel on his own show very, very soon. A lot more? Very soon. Sometimes I am very glad that nobody gives a damn about me. Because to be a person that that people are interested in means all your dirty laundry gets aired out in public all the time. And I feel bad sometimes for people like Britney Spears. I feel so bad for her because we're constantly watching her and her situation. And is she okay? And is she not okay? And did she do something crazy or did she not? And we've been following her conservatorship. And look, we follow it because it's great drama. People love drama, and I guess we love it even more when it's real. Now, as I'm saying this to you, I also realize her high profile may well have helped her get out from under this conservatorship. Her battle to get out from under her conservatorship was made very public because she's very famous and because it was very dramatic, is very dramatic. And you know, she went to that hearing and the audio came out of her telling the judge about how terrible all this is. She can't even have a baby without getting somebody's permission. And now we have gotten to the point where she was allowed to hire her own attorney. And her father now has filed court papers saying, fine by me if we want to end this conservatorship. Maybe it's time for her to get back to controlling her life, which to me suggests strongly that she's not going to be under the conservatorship too much longer. And I guess that only happened for her because of her high profile, because there's another child star who has been under a conservatorship for a while, and you don't hear as much about it. Amanda Bynes. Did you even know Amanda Bynes was under a conservatorship? And, of course, you don't hear as much about it because, and this sounds cruel, but I don't mean it to be cruel. It's just a fact. Britney Spears, way, way more famous than Amanda Bynes. And so much more focus. More people trying to hang around, sniff around, and get photos. More people interested when there's court action. Britney Spears has had the Free Britney movement for quite some time. There is a Free Bynes Twitter account. It was only created last month, and it has like 500 followers. So will Britney Spears' apparent success in bringing a lot of attention to the issue of conservatorships, will it help Amanda Bynes? It might indirectly. You know, Amanda Bynes went through, I just want to touch on it briefly. She had some period of substance abuse and she had retired from acting. And then she did some tweets that people thought maybe, you know, this person might be having trouble. Now, she's led a much more private life. Britney Spears, while under the conservatorship, was in Vegas performing. Was still kind of a high-profile celebrity. Amanda Bynes, a much more private life. And then her family's attorney decided he had to go to the press and tell the press that she was getting help for mental health problems. You know, I don't know that that was necessary. And now there is a headline out there that Amanda Bynes' conservatorship has been extended until at least 2023. And then a lawyer came out and said, that's not true. It hasn't been extended until at least 2023. It's still a day-to-day thing. And don't believe those headlines. And then told us a little information that, Amanda Bynes likes Soul Cycle. And she meditates. And she's gotten a tattoo on her face that matches her nose piercing. So on the one hand, I feel like, dude, why do you have to tell us this? I don't even want to know this. But then I do think about the fact that it was the high profile that may have helped Britney Spears finally get out from under this conservatorship. And so maybe it's what comes with the territory, that if you have any level of fame at all, you may want somebody talking to the press about you, because maybe that brings the pressure. And so it's actually the people nobody gives a damn about that never can get this kind of help. People put into conservatorships that they shouldn't be in, people being abused financially, emotionally in those conservatorships, and they're not Britney Spears, and they're not even Amanda Bynes. And their lawyers never talk to the press. So I guess it's the thing of, hey, man, we're very glad to not be famous and to be someone that nobody cares about until you're facing a problem that you can only solve if people care. Let's get a news update from Layla Mohammed. And then, the UN is now talking about a massive threat to human rights. Wait till you hear what it is. This is KFI AM 640, live everywhere on the iHeartRadio app.
Hey, it's Conway here. Know why I got a whole house water filtration system from Purigen Water? Because I don't want to wonder if my family's tap water is safe. No more wasting money on bottled water, no plastic bottles to recycle, and no more visits to the chiropractor's office because you're lifting 5-gallon bottles of water or 40 pounds of salt. No calcium buildup on faucets or shower heads, and that alone is worth it. Purigen extends the life of your water heater. Ding dong with this clean water. Purigen Water offers free lifetime service. No one else can make that claim. The system takes up a little tiny amount of space. So let's get Purigen, California's preferred whole house water filtration system. And for a limited time, when you buy a whole house system, you get the 6-stage alkaline drink system for free. 844-80-WATER. 844-80-WATER. That's purigenwater.com. Spelled wrong, but the water's right. 844-80-WATER.
The Purigen man is your best friend. Make your water pure again.
The level of connection you feel in your home dramatically influences your experiences there. Get the tools to control that connection in your communities with the first multifamily platform that unifies management and resident experiences to create smart apartments. Talk to a RealPage consultant today to see how your properties can meet the future of multifamily with the Smart Building Suite.